from the heart of where innovation, money, and power collide. In Silicon Valley and beyond, this is Bloomberg Technology with Emily Chang.
Chang in San Francisco, and this is Bloomberg Technology coming up in the next hour. For the first time ever, streaming topped cable, with U.S. viewers watching more on Netflix, Hulu, and Disney Plus, and more than cable television. We'll dig in to a historic sea change in entertainment and just how far the wave will go. Plus, the venture capitalist who claims Apple is the greatest monopolist today, why he thinks regulators are losing the plot while chasing Meta and Amazon. And it could be the fire festival of travel startups. We'll tell you about Pollen, the luxury trip planner that blew up during COVID. It started with big concerts canceled, then things quickly spiraled out of control. We'll get to all of that in a moment, but first, stocks sliding, including the high-fly meme stock Bed Bath & Beyond, after investors learned Ryan Cohen's firm officially sold its stake. Joining us now, Bloomberg's Katie Greifeld with more. And a lot of investors, Katie, not happy with Ryan Cohen today.
Not happy at all, just to put it mildly. And of course, what happened with Bed Bath & Beyond really feeds into what we saw overall. If you look at sort of the broad markets, you have the NASDAQ 100, your big tech index, falling 2% today. That even wasn't the worst of it. If you look at the Philadelphia Semiconductor Index, those chip stocks, down almost 3%. You look at some of the biggest losers, of course. You have Apple. That explains what happened there. You have NVIDIA falling almost 5%. Again, just a sea of red behind me. But let's get to Bed Bath & Beyond, because sea of red doesn't even come really close to describing it. Down 52%. Worst day ever for this stock. Of course, that's after Ryan Cohen sold out his entire stake. That's after just 7 months or so in the company. So a really quick turnaround. And like you said, Emily, people on Reddit, people on StockTwits, for example, none too pleased with him. But again, Bed Bath & Beyond, just a dramatic example of what we saw overall really this week. If you look at some of the worst performers, let's pull that up. Amazon.com, Meta, not having too great of a week. Those were the biggest points decliner in some of the big indexes over the week. If you look at some of the biggest percentage drops, it was DocuSign, it was Baidu. So again, just a really ugly end to what was a pretty difficult week overall.
All right, Bloomberg's Katie Greifeld, thank you for walking us through the week. Meantime, for the first time ever, U.S. viewers are watching more hours on streaming than cable, marking a historic change in entertainment. Subscribers to services like Netflix and Hulu accounted for 34.8% of all TV consumption in July, according to research from Nielsen. That edged out cable television at 34.4%, broadcast a distant 21.6%. Let's break this all down with Bloomberg's Lucas Shaw and Kevin Tran, media and entertainment analyst for the decision intelligence company Morning Consult. Lucas, I'll start with you. Set the stage here, the big picture. What do these numbers tell us?
Well, that streaming TV continues to gain share from broadcasting and cable. I mean, Nielsen rolled out this metric, the Gauge, a couple of years ago. It was one of the first of these third-party metrics that Netflix actually endorsed. It had been very skeptical of sort of the Nielsen weekly ratings. And there was a period of about a year ago, I want to say, where streaming share seemed to flatline, and you had a lot of traditional media people saying, oh, has streaming hit its peak? And that clearly hasn't happened. The one thing I would note is that if you put cable and broadcast together, pay TV still accounts for more TV viewing than streaming. But streaming's gaining share and is only going to continue to do so.
Kevin, what's your take? You know, just a couple of months ago, we were talking about Netflix losing subscribers. And here we are with these big numbers. How do you square that?
Yeah, I think it just speaks to the amazing amount of content that's available across the other services that aren't Netflix. Paramount Plus, Hulu, Apple TV Plus have all really pushed their original strategy really far ahead, especially after the initial COVID outbreak. And like Lucas just mentioned, this streaming gauge that Nielsen has rolled out has been really helpful, because the streaming companies themselves don't report a metric uniformly that can be allow others to measure, you know, usage or reach among them across each other. So it's a big moment for streaming to overtake traditional. I would expect it to continue to happen, maybe not every month, continuously as major sports seasons start, like the NBA, but I don't think this will be the first time we see streaming overtake traditional TV.
What do you think the difference is, Kevin, between Netflix and Disney Plus? You know, we've been concerned about Netflix losing subscribers, but Disney, according to its latest earnings report, gaining subscribers.
Yeah, I think the main difference is Disney's historic vault of IP, which families and really consumers globally can identify with and, you know, really go back to growing up with those types of franchises. And Netflix has been pushing forward with its initiative to build out more franchises for titles like Stranger Things and other big originals that it's rolled out. So it's trying to push the envelope in terms of franchising titles as well, so that streamers or consumers have a better idea of what they're signing up for with the original strategy of Netflix, which I think a lot of people have more of an idea of what Disney Plus will offer with their originals.
Now, there was a question when Disney launched Disney Plus about whether it would be too kid-focused. I was recently speaking with Ross Gerber, longtime investor in Disney. Take a listen to what he had to say about that.
Parents like me absolutely trust Disney content with my kids. And, you know, just recently I took YouTube away from them because YouTube Shorts has become the garbage hole of hell. And I don't want my kids watching garbage hole content. And if I put them on Disney Plus, there's nothing they can watch that's bad. So I think parents really trust the brand, and that's starting to really pay off for them.
Lucas, do you agree with what he said about YouTube? And also, can Disney really win over adults?
There's no question that parents trust Disney. I think that Ross is in the minority in terms of parent behavior. You look at the most popular channels on YouTube in any given week, and almost all of them are kids' channels. It's become a default babysitter for so many different families that there's not really a comparison. The other thing to keep in mind with Disney is Disney didn't grow in the US, so it's not like there are a bunch of parents who are signing up for Disney here. It's really overseas where Disney's been quite strong. And that challenge that you outlined at the top is still one for Disney, which is that it's really good with parents, it's really good with fanboys, people and fangirls, people who love Star Wars, Marvel, and the like. But it has to try to broaden its appeal to a wider group of people. It's something that they're working on. That's why they've started adding R-rated movies. It's why you're going to see more different types of programming on Disney Plus, because they need that to keep growing to keep Wall Street excited about the company.
Meantime, Lucas, Walmart also getting into streaming, teaming up with Paramount. Of course, Amazon has Amazon Prime Video. What exactly are Walmart customers going to get from this tie-up? And is it smart?
Well, if you are a customer of Walmart Plus, which is, if we want to, you know, make things simple, sort of like Walmart's equivalent of Amazon Prime, you will have access to Paramount Plus, which is Paramount's streaming service. And that's, you know, they're trying to, Walmart experimented with making its own video service, Vudu. It didn't work very well. They're leaning on a trusted and growing brand in Paramount Plus. It has the potential to be mutually beneficial, but it works for Paramount, if Walmart signs up a bunch of people for Walmart Plus. And it works for Walmart if the Paramount is, you know, enticing enough to get more people to sign up for its service. It's pretty early. Walmart Plus is very small compared to something like Amazon Prime.
Meantime, some big news in sports entertainment. You've got Paramount renewing the rights to the Champions League football matches. You've also got Fox, NBC, CBS teaming up for the Big Ten. I wonder, Kevin, is sports really the next and only way for these streamers to get to the next level, a whole new level, not an incremental level?
Yeah, I think so. And not just sports, but news as well. So, you know, a lot of these newer streamers with the wave that started in late 2019 launching, they came out of the gate strong with originals like The Mandalorian from Disney Plus, The Morning Show from Apple TV Plus. But one of the big things that consumers still can't really do with access to these major services like Netflix, Paramount Plus, and Apple TV Plus is access a significant amount of live broadcasts from the major sports leagues like the NFL or NBA. So it's not surprising that we're seeing these big packages increasingly being signed, by these companies. And I think we're at a point where consumers already have access to so many on-demand scripted and unscripted content choices that right now it's really up to the streamers to differentiate themselves with live content and sports being a major part of that.
Apple has been dabbling with sports content. Lucas, I mean, where are the battle lines going to be drawn? I mean, which streamers are going to be bidding for what? And is that going to be the next wave of big competition?
Well, the most aggressive of the streaming services in sports, if you take ESPN Plus out of the equation, because that's really part of the broader ESPN empire, has been Amazon. Amazon has Thursday Night Football coming up in a couple of weeks. They have a lot of rights in Europe. They were a big player for both the Big Ten and Champions League and just didn't get it. So they've shown the biggest commitment and appetite. Apple has started to play around the edges. They have the MLS rights. They're seen as the front runner for NFL Sunday Ticket. Netflix hasn't jumped in a big way yet. They offered a pretty, what sounded like kind of a paltry sum for the Formula One rights. They have been reluctant to spend big on live sports just yet. You know, we'll see what comes with the next big rights negotiations. You have the NBA, NASCAR coming up in a couple of years. If one of those leagues or organizations tries to carve out some rights for streaming, that would be another big package to go. But it's worth keeping in mind that, say, with something like the NFL, Amazon is the only major streaming service that has largely exclusive rights. You know, most of the other games are on broadcast TV.
All right. New potential battleground. Bloomberg's Lucas Shaw, Kevin Tran of Morning Consult. Thank you both. Lots to watch. Okay, coming up, we're going to take the temperature in the VC world as public markets continue to roil with benchmark partner Eric Vishria, who, by the way, also just called out Apple for being the greatest monopolist today. He's next. This is Bloomberg.
Apple has identified its next big business, bringing advertisements to more parts of your iPhone. Today, Apple pushes ads in three places: the App Store, Apple News, and the Stocks app. In the News and Stocks apps, Apple shows display advertisements. That means that third-party companies like car dealerships or mortgage lenders can showcase their advertisements just like they can on a website. On the App Store, the situation is different. There, Apple has search ads. This allows developers to buy their way into showing up higher on search results. For instance, an App Store developer can bid for the term car racing or basketball so their apps would surface above competing apps in the list of results. Apple's push into ads is a little ironic given that its ATT, or App Tracking Transparency Privacy feature, limits the ability for Meta, Snap, and even smaller developers to generate as much revenue as possible from advertising. That's because the feature allows users to choose if they want their data collected and tracked across third-party apps and websites. Still, Apple's hoping to expand its own ads business and is planning to add search ads to its Maps app. Other areas where ads could eventually appear are in Apple Books and Apple Podcasts, along, maybe one day, with an ad-supported tier of Apple TV Plus to compete with new offerings from Netflix and other streaming video providers. I'm Mark Gurman. This is Power On.
You can subscribe to Mark's weekly Power On newsletter at Bloomberg.com. I want to talk more now about Apple and ads with benchmark partner Eric Vishria, who has a few opinions about the iPhone maker's privacy changes. Eric, thank you so much for joining us. You had a tweet that caught our eye this week saying that while regulators chase Amazon and meaningless tiny acquisitions from Facebook, the greatest monopolist today, Apple, has taken a Trumpian tact, pushing a privacy narrative while stifling competition and favoring their own ads business. Oof. Why do you think Apple is the greatest monopolist today?
I think that at the end of the day, Apple has tremendous market power. And as Mark was saying, with the ATT rollout that they had, which they've done under the cover of privacy, they are simultaneously, and I think ironically, pushing their own ads business. And so while they're crippling other ads businesses, they are growing their own and benefiting and favoring their own. And look, Facebook, Amazon, they're going to be fine. I'm not really worried about them. But there are thousands of small companies, direct-to-consumer businesses, mom-and-pop shops that sell products online and targeted via those ad networks, gaming companies that are collateral damage with the ATT rollout. And so my concern is more for those companies than it is for Facebook and Amazon.
Why take the Trumpian tact, the Trumpian comparison?
I think it's the hypocrisy of saying one thing, which is, hey, this is about privacy and privacy to consumers, while simultaneously building and growing your own ad network with its own targeting capabilities. Like, it's literally in direct conflict with each other.
So what do you think the government should be doing instead?
I just think the regulators need to think about, like, what is actually impacting consumers and small businesses, and with that lens, choose their targets. You know, Facebook making a meaningless acquisition in virtual reality is not, that doesn't negatively impact consumers. It doesn't hurt the ecosystem. It's totally fine. Whereas, you know, this type of behavior, it's more complicated. It's more sophisticated, but it is actually impacting small businesses and consumers.
Still, Meta arguing that their acquisition of this VR company within Unlimited would actually be good for competition. Do you buy that?
I do. I think that if we're in the earliest days of virtual reality in many ways, there are no established metaverse winners or Goliaths as it is today. We don't even really know what it is and what form it's going to take over the next 5 or 10 years. And so, you know, small acquisitions with teams and technology where everyone is trying to figure it out still, that's okay. Like, I feel like that's healthy competition. Maybe it'll turn into something, maybe it won't. We don't know yet. Whereas I think some of these other markets are much, much more established, and companies have a lot of market power, like Apple.
We're looking at the stock plunges of these companies here today. Apple seems to be weathering the downturn the best.
Definitely.
What's your view and Benchmark's view of what's happening in the markets right now, with, of course, the benefit of, you know, Bill Gurley and the hindsight of, you know, being in the late 90s, you know, one of the top tech analysts on Wall Street?
Look, I think that one of the things that Benchmark has done consistently since our founding in the mid 90s is invest consistently. Most of what we do, 90% of the companies we invest in are 10 people or less at the time of investment. And so when you're doing that, you have a very long-term view where you're not going to make money for 8 or 10 years if one of those small companies grows into something big. And so over the years, we want to be consistent. Pre-global financial crisis, post-global financial crisis, in the last few years, and even now, actually, our investment pace is almost identical. We're making the same number of investments every year. And so I think that consistency is really huge for the business that we're in. Obviously, the last few years, I would say, were characterized by FOMO in the growth markets. There was so much money sloshing around. There were rounds getting done at insane prices with very little diligence. And so actually, I think this correction broadly is healthy. A lot of speculators will get wiped out. A lot of people who were only here to make a quick buck will get wiped out. And I think you'll be left with a lot of people who have real visions, believers, who are willing to put everything into it. And I think that's ultimately healthy. And so I'm actually optimistic. You know, every once in a while, a little spring cleaning or cutting is good.
So here we are in the middle of a correction, and you've got a lot of controversy surrounding Andreessen Horowitz writing not just a check to controversial WeWork founder Adam Neumann, but its biggest check ever. What do you make of that?
As you know, we didn't participate in that round, although we were Series A investors in WeWork. We did not participate in this recent $350 million round. And I can't defend another firm's investment. There's no value in doing that, and I'm not inside their heads. I would say this about Adam: we can debate a lot of things, but he is definitely top 0.001% in terms of his ability to separate people from their money. And I'll leave it at that.
Hang on, you can't leave it at that. What do you mean by that?
He is very, very good at raising money, as he's shown time and time again. And he's done that again here.
Would you write him another check?
We didn't.
All right. So what do you think that says about Silicon Valley? Is it a broader indictment of Silicon Valley, or does it showcase a problem of Silicon Valley, or is this a very specific issue with potentially Andreessen Horowitz?
I think these mega rounds, I can't pretend to know what goes into a mega round or a growth round like this. I don't know what the calculus is. That isn't the type of investment that we make. You know, the vast majority of what we do is, you know, $5, $10, $15 million investments in really small companies in their earliest stages, where we're making a 10-year commitment to work with them. And so I think that's the business I know. I think there's a lot of there's been a lot of changes in growth investing with SoftBank and lots of firms raising larger and larger funds, but that isn't what we've done. So I can't speak to it.
All right. Eric Vishriya, partner, Benchmark. Appreciate you stopping by, Eric. Thank you.
Thanks for having me.
We will be right back. This is Bloomberg Technology. The biggest producer of the nickel used in electric car batteries wants to be seen as more than just a source of resources. Indonesia's president spoke to Bloomberg's editor-in-chief, John Micklethwaite.
Ya, yang kita inginkan semua adalah mobil listriknya.
What we want is the electric cars, not the battery. For Tesla, we want to build electric cars in Indonesia. From Ford, electric cars. Hyundai, electric cars. From Japan, Toyota, Suzuki. And we want a huge ecosystem of electric cars.
Indonesia has held talks on potential partnerships with Tesla over several years, but there have been no agreements. All right, coming up, a look at how funding for women-led startups has changed since the pandemic. That's next. Back to the story that's had everyone talking this week in Silicon Valley. Andreessen Horowitz writing its biggest check ever to controversial WeWork founder Adam Neumann. The check, $350 million, instantly making Flow, Neumann's new real estate startup, a unicorn. Yes, the same Neumann whose WeWork hit a peak valuation of $50 billion, then plummeted to $8 billion with lots of people losing their jobs and some investors losing lots of money. There have been quite a few tweets about this on both sides of the debate, including this from Winnie founder Sarah Muscov. People always ask me why I defend quote-unquote toxic female founders and associate my brand with female leaders who might have done bad things. It's because women leaders aren't held to standards. Women leaders are held to standards men are not. Men get $350 million. Women get ostracized. If I don't speak up, who will? Sarah Muscov joining me now, CEO and co-founder of Winnie. We'll get to that. But tell me, like, why did you want to speak up about this?
Yeah, I thought you were going to mention my viral joke tweet making fun of Adam.
That was good, too. It was a little more inside baseball, but you could explain.
It's all good. My comedy career is my next act. But, you know, I don't think anyone was really surprised that Adam Neumann was able to raise a mega round of funding. I think what really struck a chord with a lot of founders, especially women founders, is that he was given this second chance when so many women and underrepresented minorities aren't even given a first chance. And you know, what other big, bold ideas and founders could we uncover if we invested in people besides white men?
You know, I've spoken to a lot of people this week and a lot of people who didn't want to speak publicly about this, you know, don't want to say anything negative about Andreessen Horowitz. Why do you think people won't talk about it?
I mean, I don't think this is unique to Andreessen Horowitz. I think in venture capital as a whole, there's been a really big emphasis on, you know, sort of growth at all costs and, you know, burning lots of cash on your way to the top. And I actually am pretty optimistic because I think that is really changing. And I think that will serve women founders really well. Women get just 2% of the venture capital. And so we have always had to operate, you know, in a profitable way or on the path to profitability. And now that is finally getting some respect. It's not just growth and burning lots of cash. It's actually growth that's sustainable. And that's what we've always done at Winnie. And I think a lot of women founders have always done.
I think part of the risk is, you know, if you come forward, would you ever get a check from Andreessen Horowitz, which is, you know, one of the most prestigious venture capital firms in Silicon Valley? Why take that risk? That you might never get funding from them.
I think, you know, either way, like, this is not anything having to do with just Andreessen Horowitz. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of firms across the board, I mean, this is an industry-wide number that 2% of the venture capital goes to women founders, and even less if you look at, you know, underrepresented women founders. So I don't think this is unique to them. I think this is just a great example and time to say, like, hey, what about all the women who weren't given second chances after they made a big bet that didn't work out?
And or the many that never got a first chance.
And many that didn't even get a first chance. And I think now is actually a really good time to talk about it because there is this greater emphasis, aside from this case, a much greater emphasis on profitability and, you know, sustainable growth.
You and I talked when you were launching Winnie. What has your experience been like raising money, not just as a female founder, but a founder raising money for a marketplace for childcare?
It's been rough. I think childcare has historically been really underfunded and undervalued and overlooked and all the things. It's a $90 billion market, childcare for kids under six in the US alone annually. So it's massive. But the money just really hasn't been there. And I think, you know, when you're building in an industry that's so big and so entrenched, and you're trying to innovate, it takes a long time. And so a lot of what was invested in the past were these like really quick wins, and like you wanna grow really fast at all costs. And that's not the way you innovate in childcare. It's just not gonna work. It's so entrenched, it's so big, it's so fragmented. And so we've, you know, taken a slower growth approach. We've been at this for almost 7 years. We were really fortunate to find investors who believed in kind of the long haul. And now, you know, we are the leading marketplace for group childcare and early education. But it's taken almost 7 years to get there. It did not happen overnight. And we had to be really careful with how we grew so that we would have the time and the runway to get to where we are now.
What's the funding environment like now? You know, we're in the middle of this big market correction. You're hearing about down rounds and flat rounds and layoffs.
Yeah.
Is it harder than it's been?
If I could give advice to other companies, it would be, you know, if you can get to profitability, get there. Yeah. I think we feel like we have so much more predictability in our own revenue and growth than in what investors are going to like or be able to invest in, or, you know, can they raise from their LPs. That we're focusing internally on just our business, and we're really fortunate to be in a position to do that. We've never been able to count on the next round of funding. I think there have been companies, especially in the childcare space, that have raised more and grown faster, and they're finding themselves in a tough spot right now because that next round of funding is not just out there, easy to get.
What's the state of the childcare industry right now, post-COVID, post-pandemic? What are you seeing?
One of the biggest issues right now in childcare is the teacher shortage, so the early educator shortage. So we hear about that all the time with, you know, public education, but it's even worse in childcare, and it's really, really affecting these businesses. They're having to close classrooms, take less children into their program. It's creating this huge supply issue. So that's kind of one of the things we're now really focused on at Winnie, is helping daycares and preschools hire staff in addition to filling their open spaces. Because if they don't have the teachers, they can't fill spaces. They can't meet ratios.
So you know, what are the problems that we're not talking about, and how do you see those problems being resolved?
Problems in childcare? I mean, I think one big problem is the lack of investment. It does take investment to innovate. We see this in pretty much every other industry. So it's hard when you have to grow just based on your profits. Mm-hmm. It's slower and it takes more time. So I would absolutely love to see more investment, not just from venture capitalists, though that would be nice, but also from employers, from the government. Mm-hmm. You know, Build Back Better was supposed to be this great big influx of cash to childcare. None of that is happening. And so, you know, there is really a lack of investment going towards childcare. And I think it can come from many different sources, but someone's got to step up here.
I also want to ask you about Twitter. You've worked at a lot of different tech companies before you started your own. You worked at Twitter. What do you think about Elon Musk potentially owning Twitter? Would Elon be good for Twitter?
He actually just recently tweeted something like, you know, being a mom, which he's a dad, so it's a little weird he's tweeting about moms, but being a mom is just as important as any career. And to me, that's just kind of like an underhanded way of saying, you know, moms, you go stay at home and take care of kids, leave us men to the careers. I don't think that's a fit for Twitter's culture. It's you know, I haven't worked there in a while, but I am sure they would not agree with that kind of statement or approach towards, they hire lots of women, they have lots of moms working in leadership roles. They have been big supporters and advocates of getting more women in leadership. So that just, to me, seems really not aligned with their culture at all.
What about the product itself? I mean, I'm sure even you would agree that, like, potentially there could have been more innovation at Twitter over the last decade. They could be making more money. They could have grown a lot faster. Maybe they need an Elon Musk.
Maybe they
to
need
shake
more,
things up.
Maybe they need more women, more moms working there. I think also, you know, this has just been a massive distraction for the employees. So mm-hmm. when you talk about innovation, I mean, how can you possibly focus on 100% on innovating and making the product better for users if you have this massive distraction going on at the same time? So I don't think this has been good on that front either.
All right. Well, we'll continue to follow the drama there on all fronts, really. And thank you for helping us work through some of it. Winnie, co-founder and CEO, Sarah Muscoff, appreciate it. All right, coming up, why Bitcoin is having its worst week in months. That is next. This is Bloomberg. For our daily crypto report, the big tokens, of course, going through a sell-off. Bitcoin dropping as much as 9% to its lowest level since late July. According to CoinGlass, some $220 million in crypto assets were liquidated in just 1 hour today. Let's bring in David Tal now, president of crypto asset fund ProChain Capital. David, how long does this downturn last for crypto?
I think it lasts through Labor Day at least. I think we're going to have some dog days of summer, not much going on. I think macro, we've had a good run up in equity markets. We've had a good run up generally in crypto, certainly very strong in Ether. And I think right now the market is deciding between should we be in a risk on environment or do we need to pay more attention to inflation rates, Fed policy, and so forth.
But how long does it extend beyond Labor Day?
I don't think very long. I think actually we will start to get some announcements after Labor Day around things that the crypto community cares about, legislation, regulation, and then potentially additional industry-related announcements like the one we received or the few that we received out of BlackRock over the past couple of weeks in terms of their foray into crypto.
Do you differentiate between Bitcoin and Ether, you know, when you consider these big potential market influencers given the merge coming up?
Right now, you have to. I think that the narrative around the merge for Ether is overpowering for it. Certainly today, it didn't matter. But I think overall, that narrative is very strong. And I think as we get closer and closer to the merge, that narrative will become stronger and stronger and really lead the charge in terms of Ether's price movement. Now, that being said, I don't know if the merge is necessarily, you know, bullish up until the very end, or it'll be bullish for some time close to, you know, the actual merge date. But then there will be a point of time where people will, you know, quote unquote, you know, start to sell the news.
Now, your fund Prochain down 53% year to date, but you actually jumped back up 19% in July. How did you buck the trend?
Well, we were, you know, we had a fair amount of risk off attitude, you know, coming through May and June. We took a bunch of obviously losses, but we also took a bunch of cash off of the table and held it in reserve to go ahead and redeploy, because we did think that things were going to go materially lower. And so we went ahead and redeployed that capital during that period of time. In addition, I have to point out, we're not only invested in tokens, but we also invest in equities that are focused on the crypto and digital payment sector. And so there we've done fairly well as well. So it's been able to balance out our portfolio.
How would you gauge broader institutional sentiment in crypto right now? Obviously, you've got, you know, the bankruptcies, you've got Celsius. How long does all this stuff hang over?
So I think the institutions, this is my firm opinion. I think the institutions have been going through an educational process for an extended period of time now, you know, the last at least 2 years, if not longer. They have the resources and the human resources in particular to go ahead and devote towards that education and becoming sophisticated. In terms of when they go ahead and decide to get involved, that usually happens, you know, over a period of time. But when they go ahead and throw down the hammer, it's actually, you know, in very serious numbers. And I think they've, you know, if I had to guess, I think a number of them have gone ahead and added or started positions during this downturn. I think they are watching, though, particularly what's going on with the bankruptcies. And you raised that point. I think it's important right now in terms of the sector generally. I think the sector is learning a lot through the liquidations and bankruptcies of Three Arrows, Celsius, Voyager, and so forth. It's a learning process in terms of being able to understand what the priorities are, legal priorities, excuse me, in terms of legal rights of account holders, depositors, and then what exactly those assets, when held, whether they be directly in accounts, whether they be directly in crypto, whether they be rights to accounts in other institutions in crypto, what exactly that shakes out to. I think institutions are very keen on learning the results of this in tandem with, at the same time, understanding the regulatory framework, right? The SEC seems to be going off without any guardrails. And I think the legislature is trying to rein them in. I don't think we'll see that reining in until the midterm elections. But I think between the legal precedent being set in those cases, coupled with the uncertainty around the legal and regulatory environment, is leaving institutions in kind of a middling position at this point, and they're not going to go in full force. But yet, they're still educating very rapidly, and I think at the right time, they will go ahead and deploy very heavily. And there's no way of knowing when that right time will be, so I think you need to be there ready and waiting for it.
All right. Thank you for your analysis there. David Tal, Prochain Capital president. Lots to watch. Appreciate you stopping by. Coming up, Fire Festival 2.0. Well, that's what some say. We're going to talk about Pollen, a luxury travel startup that is going under. More on that next. This is Bloomberg. It's branded as the new Fyre Festival fiasco. Pollen, a high-flying travel startup that planned vacations in posh locations with celebrities, has had to cancel dozens of its luxury events over the last year, prompting a wave of customer complaints. Now the company is going through a restructuring. Pollen has been blaming the Omicron variant for its misfortune, but turns out employees say executives bear some of the blame too. Let's dive into this with Bloomberg's Katie Roof, who's been all over these latest developments. Katie, what's happening here?
Sure, so good to be with you. In my 10 years in covering startups, I have to say this is one of the most unusual situations I have heard in terms of money mismanagement. This is a company that was valued at $800 million just a few months ago, and now unclear if they're going to be worth anything because they've had trouble finding any buyer at all. So it is being called Fyre Fest because it is a music-related business. They actually book festivals, and in several of them, and one in particular, earlier this year, they booked an event in Mexico for people to see the band Departure. And after people arrived, I was told even as soon as an hour before the concert was supposed to begin, it was just canceled. So people were there and there was no event. And then people didn't even get refunded. So certainly people were pretty upset about that. There have been a lot of customer complaints. And according to my sources that I've spoken to, while the company blames COVID for a lot of its misfortune, in this particular instance, they actually hadn't secured the proper permit to have the concert to begin with. So a lot of allegations of mismanagement all across the board, whether it be for poor planning or just not spending money properly.
What have we learned from employees specifically about what happened here and like the part of the story that wasn't being told?
Sure. So we've heard a lot of different things. I think one thing that we've heard that resonated was that while it seemed like they didn't have money to pay their bills and they weren't paying their bills, meanwhile, they were spending money on expensive parties for themselves, expensive villas. You know, we got a hold of some documents that said they spent over 50,000 pounds on some villa, which, you know, the company says was actually for a legitimate business purpose. But somehow it seemed like they were finding money for fun, but they were stiffing customers, they weren't paying their employees, things like pensions and now severance and other compensation. They weren't paying vendors. There's a long list of people they owe money, and they literally kept a list. They kept an Excel spreadsheet, and there was something on there said, what will happen if we don't pay these people? They were trying to figure out how to prioritize who they paid. We put in our story that sometimes it was just because someone got more attention on social media for their complaints, so that got them ahead of the line in getting a refund. So, you know, certainly a lot of allegations of mismanaged funds. We spoke to 16 people directly involved with this, and I think there's going to be more stories to come. We have a lot of pretty damning allegations that we're looking into, and you know, curious to vet that some more.
So yeah, last quick question. I mean, is this company gonna make it, or are they gonna go out of business?
Well, they struggled to find a buyer. So they hired Goldman Sachs, and they were unable to find a buyer, and you know, it was unsuccessful. So you know, will someone want to buy Pollen with all of these problems? I don't know. I mean, they did have connections. They did, you know, book Justin Bieber and other high profile events. So right. Maybe you could say there's something to their brand, but I don't know. It looks like they're having some problems.
All right. Well, we'll be watching for more of your reporting on this. Fascinating one. Bloomberg's Katie Roof. Thank you. And that does it for this edition of Bloomberg Technology. Tune in next week for a conversation about how video games are being prescribed as treatment for certain illnesses. Akili CEO with us Monday.